The next step up in size is the stellar scale. The key idea here is that the Sun is a star.
We don't usually associate this idea with any one person, but the person in the picture is Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin. In the early 20th century, she figured out what stars are mainly by studying their light. We'll look at how she did that later in the course.
So what did she find? Well, a star is just a huge ball of hydrogen and helium with a tiny amount of other chemical elements thrown in. It's all held together by its tremendous gravity. All of the stars we see in the sky are like this. Here's a look at our star. It's glowing because it's hot, but there's no flame here. Nothing is burning. It's just a lot of hot gas.
If our Sun is a star, why do other stars seem so faint compared to our Sun? Here's a picture of a group of stars called the Pleiades. You might also know them as the Seven Sisters, though you can see here that there are really hundreds of stars in this group.
We've gone through the data on these stars and found one that seems a lot like the Sun. It's the same size, the same mass, the same temperature, and it's putting out about the same amount of light. See if you can guess which one it is. When you're ready, click the mouse to see the answer.
Okay, there it is. TCY-1803-686-1. That's what our Sun looks like to the rest of the galaxy. A very ordinary background star.
The reason stars are so faint is simply that they're so far away. In fact, they're so far that we have to talk about a new unit of measurement, a light year.
A light year is a distance, not a time. Light travels incredibly fast, 300,000 kilometers per second, or 186,000 miles per second. The first person to measure this was a fellow named Ole Rømer back in the 18th century. That's him in the picture.
The speed of light seems to be a kind of cosmic speed limit. Nothing can travel faster than this. The fastest spacecraft we've sent out have only traveled at about 50 kilometers per second, 6,000 times slower than light.
So how far does a beam of light travel in 1 year? About 10 trillion kilometers, or 6 trillion miles. Remember that the outer edge of the solar system is 4.5 billion kilometers away, so a light year is more than 2,000 times as far as this.
But as we move into the stellar scale, even a light year starts looking small. The nearest star to our Sun is called Proxima Centauri. It's more than 4 light years away, and that's our closest neighbor. Most of the stars we see in the sky are tens, hundreds, or thousands of light years away.
On this map, notice something else about the stars they've shown in our neighborhood. Most of them are small red stars, like Lalande 21185 and Barnard's star, ones you've probably never heard of, even though they are some of our closest neighbors. In fact, most stars are like this, small, faint, cool stars that you wouldn't even see unless you were right on top of them.
Here's a picture showing different sizes of planets and stars. We've already seen something like this for the planets at the top, from little Mercury to big Jupiter and Saturn.
But for the moment, I'd like you to look at panel 3. Down on the left is Jupiter, the biggest planet in our solar system. The Sun is the much bigger orange ball there. Between them is a small red ball. That's a typical red dwarf star, not much bigger than Jupiter. That's what most stars look like.
Now look at the rest of the panels. Notice that the biggest star on each panel is the smallest one in the next picture. So in addition to those huge numbers of small faint stars, there is a small number of much bigger giant and supergiant stars. There aren't very many of these stars, but most of the ones that we see in the sky are like this. None of these giant stars is very close to us, but they're incredibly bright, so we can see them from a tremendous distance away. The very biggest supergiants, like all the ones in panel 6, are so big that if you dropped them into our solar system, they would fill up all of the space out to some of the outer planets.
One of the most important ideas to come out of 20th century astronomy was that stars change over time. The time scales can be incredibly long, often billions of years, but stars go through a life cycle. They're born, shine for a while, and then they die.
Stars are born in great clouds of gas and dust called molecular clouds. We're looking at one of these star factories here, the Eagle Nebula. The dark pillars are dense clouds where gas and dust is collapsing into stars. Some of the gas is glowing because of a group of newly formed stars just out of the picture. They're lighting up the nebula with high-energy radiation.
Here's another one of these molecular clouds, the Carina star-forming region. It's one of the biggest in our parts of the galaxy, and it's over 7,000 light-years away. Some of the biggest stars in our galaxy are forming right here, and because big stars don't last long, many of these stars are also close to dying.
One good example of this is Eta Carina, the bright glowing spot a little left of center. It's already starting to push its outer layers into space. You can see the glowing bubbles of gas on either side of it. In fact, since this star is 7,000 light years away, we're not seeing it the way it looks now. We're seeing it the way it looked 7,000 years ago. That's a long enough time that Eta Carina may be already gone, blown apart in a gigantic explosion. We'll know when the light from the explosion eventually reaches us. That could happen tomorrow, or it may be thousands of years from now.
So yes, stars die. Smaller stars, like the sun, die slowly and gently. After billions of years of shining, they finally start puffing out their outer layers and then lighting them up with ultraviolet light. We call these glowing clouds planetary nebulae, and they're some of the prettiest sights in the night sky. They last for a few thousand years, and then they fade away.
Here's another star doing the same thing. That bright white spot in the center is the old core of the star, now visible since the rest has been pushed out into space. Our sun will do something like this as well in about 6 billion years. Bigger stars have a more spectacular end. In just a few seconds, they blow themselves apart in a gigantic explosion called a supernova.
Almost 1,000 years ago, Chinese astronomers wrote about a guest star, a new star that suddenly appeared in the sky. It was so bright, you could see it in the daylight, and you could read by it at night, but after a few months, it faded away. 700 years later, when astronomers started looking at the sky with telescopes, they saw this expanding cloud. Luckily, the Chinese had kept good records, so one could tell that it was in the same location in the sky. This is the Crab Nebula, the debris from that giant explosion.
So what gets left behind when a star dies? There are three different possibilities, depending on how massive the star was.
Small stars, like the sun, produce a white dwarf. This is the old core of the star, now squeezed down to the size of a planet. Don't let it fool you, though. It's still got hundreds of thousands of times as much matter as the Earth, so it's almost a million times as dense as water.
A bigger star that goes through supernova produces a neutron star. Now the core of the star has been squeezed down to the size of a city, and it's so dense that just a teaspoonful would weigh as much as a mountain.
Finally, the very biggest stars produce one of the strangest objects we know of, a black hole. Here, the core of the star has been squeezed down to a point, and gravity is so strong that light falls into it and never gets out. Black holes distort both space and time around them, and if you ever see a view like this one up ahead of you, you're definitely getting too close.
There's one other thing that stars leave behind. All of that gas that they blow back out into space. This is important because while a star is shining, it's busy turning small atoms, like hydrogen, into larger atoms like helium, carbon, nitrogen, etc. At the end of a star's life, especially if it goes supernova, it creates a whole other collection of heavier elements like iron, gold, and uranium.
After all of this material is returned to space, it gets incorporated into the next generation of stars that forms. These later stars have more heavy elements than the previous generation, and this is important for us because heavy elements are what we are made of. By us, I really mean most everything in our ecosystem. People, plants and animals, and the Earth itself. Isn't that cool? We really are star stuff. Now it's your turn to do the work. Here's a cool picture of an object in space. Soon I'm going to give you a few minutes to ask yourself, what can you tell about this picture, and what would you like to know about it? But first, let me say a few words about these your turn questions that we do. They're not research questions. If you have to do an internet search, or if you have to spend a lot of time going through your book or notes, you're picking it up by the wrong end. We give these same questions to students in our traditional classes, and they rarely have more than 10 minutes to do them, so that's the way that you should approach them.
These questions are mostly designed to make you think about the material. Participating in the thinking process is the main benefit you get from them, not memorizing the answer for later.
In class, most of these are done in small groups of two or three people. If you're listening with other people, just go ahead and work with the people around you. If you're in a distance education course and you're not already part of a group, you should be soon. Make a point of discussing these questions with the people in your group. Talking it over is the best way to develop these thinking skills. Some of these questions will be graded, so you'll have to write down your reasoning and turn it in. Okay, go ahead and discuss the picture now.
When you're finished, click on the picture to learn more about this image.